owns an Olympic gold medal and American record at 200 meters. To get it, he beat 100-meter champ Carl Lewis. Now DeLoach wants to invade Lewis's territory.
In 100 meters, I like to go out and show everybody that I can be just as good as I've proved myself to be in the 200 meters. This year, I'd like to break the mold and show everybody that Joe DeLoach is not just a 200-meter runner, that I can be great at this distance also.
DeLoach's Santa Monica Track Club teammate Danny Everett is also ready to explore new horizons. Considered a 400-meter specialist by virtue of his two Olympic medals, Everett wants the world to see he can run a sharp 200 as well.
At Modesto, I'm here to stun the crowd in 200 meters because I think people realize already that I am a great 200-meter runner, so now I want to work on my 200, and Modesto is the place to do it.
Tony Dees was an indoor sensation in the hurdles. Today, he meets Olympic bronze medalist Tony Campbell.
I'm coming off the best indoor season I've had in my career, and I'm looking forward to facing Tony Campbell in Modesto Invitational.
33-year-old distance runner Doug Padilla won more than $15,000 during the indoor track season. The four-time national 5,000-meter champion is a fast finisher. Today, Padilla will test himself at 1,500 meters against a true speedster. Coming up from the 800, Johnny Gray holds the American record at that distance and at 1,000 yards. The 1,500 meters for men will match Padilla's strength against Gray's blazing speed. In the field event, Sheila Hudson, the Golden Bear from Cal Berkeley, is peerless among female triple jumpers. The defending collegiate champion at both the long and triple jump, today she performs in front of a home crowd in her best event, the triple. Mike Powell is the second male long jumper to win a basketball dunking shootout. But what he'd really like to do is beat Carl Lewis and be number one in his own event.
Here at Modesto, I'd like to establish myself as a 28-footer and be consistent throughout the year and to show that I'm the one who's going to be Carl this year.
From Modesto, California, ESPN, the Total Sports Network, presents Championship Track and Field. Today, live, the 49th running of the S&W Modesto Invitational. In a region known for its wine grapes, raisins are the more likely product today as the mercury soars toward 90 degrees with low humidity and a light breeze doing very little to cool things down. Hello, everyone. I'm Bob Varsha welcoming you to Modesto, California, famous for three things. Its agricultural bounty, being the inspiration for the hit film American Graffiti, and for one of the great meets in all of track and field, now in its 49th edition. With me to call the action in these Modesto Invitational Games, once again, ESPN track and field expert Larry Ross. To whom the first question has to be, how will these conditions affect performance?
Bob, the Santa Monica Track Club is here. When you have talent like that here, it's in the sprints primarily. They are terrific. And the sprints will be helped by the warm weather here. We have to see what the wind actually will do for the competitors.
Well, certainly the field event athletes like warm conditions. Dwight Stones will be covering them as well as interviewing our winners. Here's Dwight.
Well, Bob and Larry, we all know from watching this Modesto Invitational for some 20 years that this place is a thrower's mecca. And there are a couple reasons for that. First, and without question, the most important being the availability and amount of talented weightmen based in the San Jose and San Francisco Bay Area over the years. Modesto is a logical place for them to congregate for a meet. That draws the best throwers from around the country and creates a competitive environment that is unrivaled by other U.S.-based meets. The other significant reason is the favorable prevailing winds that blow in from the north for the discus throwers. They almost consistently produce yearly list-leading performances here in Modesto. And here's a partial list of some of the throwing veterans, the legends that have competed here in Modesto. In the hammer, Hal Connolly, Olympic champion. Ed Burke, 15 years the American record holder. In the shot, Al Feuerbach, former world record holder. George Woods, former world record holder, Olympic silver medalist. Randy Mattson, world record holder, Olympic champion. In the discus, Mack Wilkins, world record holder, Olympic champion and silver medalist. John Powell, Bell, Olympic medalist. Jay Sylvester, world record holder. Al Order, four-time Olympic champion. And today we take another look at Wolfgang Schmidt. We follow him all during the spring. That's when he does some great throwing. He is here today, formerly of East Germany, now representing West Germany. We also have a full complement of field events on tap today, and I'll be bringing you all the action and the interviews from down here on the field.
Thank you, Dwight, but let's not forget that great 1,500-meter matchup between distance man Doug Padilla coming down, 800-man Johnny Gray moving up. ESPN coverage of this S&W Modesto Invitational is brought to you by Bud Light. Everything else is just a light. By Best Western. Best Western has 3,300 properties in 33 countries worldwide. And by the Century 21 system. Put your trust in number one. When we come back to Modesto, we'll have our first running event of the day, the women's 800 meters, live track and field, coming your way here on ESPN. Stay with us. Welcome back to Modesto, California, and live coverage of the S&W Modesto Invitational. We're ready for the women's 800 meters, the world record 1:53.28, held by Jarmila Kratok-Vilova in Munich, 1983. The American mark held by Mary Slaney, 1:56.90. The collegiate record, 1:58.33, and here's the way they'll line up for today's event. It'll be Kendra Brandup next to Karen Locke, Marcia Tate, the ex-Nebraska star from Jamaica, next to her, Courtney Clark, a sophomore at Cal Berkeley, Michelle Taylor, Christine Olin, Sonia Sutherland, 17-year-old California high school girl Becky Spies in there, Leslie Nall, Renee Manfredi, Marlene Harmon Wilcox, married to TV star Larry Chips Wilcox, Debbie Roach, Shannon Leader, Shaylin Carr, and Teresa Toy. A big field in the women's 800.
You're pretty good with all those names.
How do you like the way I rolled those off, huh? If I could just get S&W out, I'll be in good shape.
Impressive. The women's 800 meters. 800 meters is about 5 yards shorter than the old 880 yards that we would hear about. Metric distances and 400 and 800 are just slightly shorter. Huge field. It's going to be interesting to see how in this nine-lane Chevron 400 track, as it's called. There you see Marcia Tate, the star from Jamaica, who ran very well at this meet here last year, has had a troubling indoor season. She's been working on a lot of over distance, has not done much speed work, did not run well at the British Commonwealth Games Championships. She is now out of Nebraska, is training there, and says she's about to really begin her speed training. She said, this is my first major race. I don't really know how well I'll do.
She has a personal best of 2:00.78. That makes her the quickest in the field based on PR, personal record, personal best performance.
Two athletes per lane. They will run in staggered lanes around the first turn.
Once they cross the end of the turn, they will break for the pole, and I'll reiterate, this is a big crowd in this field.
Michelle Taylor pulling off in a lead. Former University of Southern California star has run right on 2 minutes. And there you see Karen Locke out there pressing the pace. I think Locke's goal here looks like she might want a rabbit, Bob.
Looks like it. Once again, it is a very hot day here in Modesto, and there is a strong breeze that will be blowing in the runners' faces as they make this turn right here.
You got it. This is what I was going to point out. Every time you see them down the far end of the track, they're going into probably a 10 or 15, maybe even a 20-mile-an-hour gusts of wind.
The breeze has really picked up. It has been bright sunshine all weekend. It was actually 99 degrees yesterday here in Modesto, so being about 90 today is a much cooler situation for these athletes. Karen Locke, your leader. Michelle Taylor, who's University of Southern California teammate, is also in this field. Leslie Knoll.
That is Michelle Taylor starting to pull away. Marcia Tate is running right now in second place.
60.4 seconds unofficially at 400 meters.
Good solid pace. Probably tough to get under 2 minutes. It's early in the season. Taylor has run 2:03 earlier this year at Mount SAC, and she's got control of this race right now, the powerful young lady for the Southern California Cheetahs.
Looking up the backstretch, somebody's stepping off. Looks like Marlene Wilcox stepped off. But there is the gap from Michelle Taylor back to the rest of the field. She has 15 yards on the rest of the girls. There's a look at the pack being led now by Karen Locke. She's being challenged hard. Off the turn they come. Michelle Taylor from the Southern California Cheetahs. Second of the 1989 National Collegiate 800 meters is just blowing away this field.
Tate's in second. Here comes Leslie Knoll pulling into second place past Tate. It's Taylor's race, though.
Michelle Taylor is your winner, unofficially 2:03. Second will be Leslie Knoll. And Marcia Tate comes home third.
Well, it's 60-64. Pretty typical the way people run today. Both the men and the women go out 3 to 4 seconds faster than they seem to come back in. Very hard to equal it. There you see down the home stretch, a look at the back. She built up her margin on the straightaway, on the back stretch as she started to pull away. Look at the power and strength. She's also a very fine 400-meter runner, having run on the relay legs under 52 seconds. So she is certainly a woman for the future for the United States at 800 meters and possibly 400. Second place goes to Leslie Knoll.
Dwight Stones is standing by now with our winner.
Thank you, Bob. Michelle Taylor, an awful lot of wind on that backstretch. You're very, very strong right now, and you have the 400-meter speed. 2:01 last year. I have a feeling you plan to improve upon that this year with this race.
I'm going to try and go under 2 this year. I got a good start right now. A little bit more work to do. Not going to be easy getting under 2, but I think I can do it.
You gonna concentrate primarily on the 800, or are you gonna run some 400s?
I'm gonna run a couple 4s, but I'm concentrating primarily on the 8.
You're in pain, aren't you?
Very much so.
Was the wind tough to deal with? I can feel it blowing right here. I can't imagine running into it from 500 to 600 meters on this track.
It was tough, but Tuesday in Los Angeles was real tough too. So I was kind of ready for it.
Well, the conditions will probably improve when you get over to Europe in the closed stadiums. Congratulations, Michelle Taylor. Outstanding performance.
Thank you.
A powerful performance for Michelle Taylor, who is our winner. We'll take a quick step away. Come back with the men's 400 relay, Leslie Knoll and Marcia Tate, second and third. In the men's 4x100-meter relay, the world and American records 37.83, set by Sam Grady, Ron Brown, Calvin Smith, and Carl Lewis way back in 1984. We have a terrific lineup for this event. The University of Idaho in lane 1. Lane 2, Blinn Junior College, the National Junior College champions. Lane 3, from Florida, the Florida Clippers, owned by George Steinbrenner, a man with some baseball background. Lane 5 will be the Santa Monica Track Club. Joe DeLoach, Mark Witherspoon, Danny Everett, and Henry Thomas. Sports Track Club will be next to them. Then the University of Washington, the Stars and Stripes Track Club, and the South Bay TC.
Keep an eye particularly on lane 4. You see everybody there. Lane 4 will have the Florida Clippers, and there is Boris Goings, who will be the leadoff man for the Florida Clippers. They lead the nation with a 38.85 one-hundredths of a second clocking for a lap around the track. There you see Joe DeLoach, who will be leading off for Santa Monica for the track club. Terrific team that he has with him. Extremely deep.
And I get the feeling that this is much more of a grudge match than it otherwise would be in the early season. The Florida Clippers lifted their number 2 man, Gary Duncan, and inserted Clarence Daniel.
There's Stanley Kerr, the leadoff man for Sports Track Club. Kerr, a young man from a small town in Texas, has had a fine career. Very good leadoff man, runs the turns well. That's why he's leading off for the team. The athletes have 20 meters to pass the baton, and they may start their run 10 meters before that zone.
They are away. The first and third runners will be on the turn. The second and fourth men will have straightaways. There's the Santa Monica Club right in the middle of your picture.
Only a fair exchange there.
Santa Monica and Sports TC, I make it in the early going. Let's see what happens now as they head into the third leg.
Danny Everett taking the baton. They also stutter step there. There he is in the center of the screen in blue.
Danny Everett, Lorenzo Daniel for the Clipper Club. Greg Holmes with Stars and Stripes doing well along the outside. But it looks like it's going to be the Clippers and the Santa Monica Club.
That's Tony Dees running in the inside.
It looks like he's got... No, Henry Thomas from Santa Monica came on very hard at the end as Dees goes down, and I think he knows he was caught at the end. Tremendous closing rush there by Henry Thomas, a California high school product.
Look at his shoulder. Look at the skin he ripped off his shoulder. Do you believe that?
Wow, this is an old track. It's an artificial surface, and they do get hard and abrasive as they get older.
Now watch, Danny Everett is not used to running the turn. He probably runs the straightaways just a little bit better. Henry Thomas, world-class sprinter, is right now in front of Tony Dees, who is the star of the indoor season. Most people think he's running brilliantly at 100 meters. Look at him slightly gain on Thomas. Two of the world's best going at each other. A photo finish. And you're not landing on grass either.
That's right. Tony Dees went down. He's got a hurdle event coming up later on the day. Ooh, bad shoulder. I hope he's able to come back. Here it is from straight on.
There was a point here where I thought that Dees actually caught him, and Thomas seemed to come back on him ever so slightly. Oh, what a fall.
39.16, unofficially, the winner, Santa Monica Track Club. So Henry Thomas closed down Tony Dees there at the end.
There are the official splits. A fine race considering slightly windy conditions, Bob.
Let's get down to Dwight Stones.
Thanks, guys. Mark Witherspoon, you took the stick from Joe DeLoach, a fantastic turn runner. You really cooked the backstretch. Are you over all the injuries that have kept you sidelined for a while?
Yeah, I've been training pretty hard this year. My hamstring has been doing pretty well. I think this year I may stay away from injuries if I can help with myself.
Danny, you got the stick from Mark. It was a pretty good pass. And then again, you're a fabulous turn runner. You're concentrating on some 200 meters this year. Did you feel like you had it wrapped up at that point?
I really wasn't sure because I knew our competition, the Florida Clippers, was behind me, and I really wasn't sure exactly where they were, but I just went out and ran a hard curve and tried to get the stick to Henry as fast as possible.
Henry, you got the stick on the outside of the lane. You may have run a meter further than you really needed to. You must have heard Tony Dees coming with about 50 meters to go.
Oh, yeah, I knew he was there. I knew he'd be there all along. Me and Danny had a good exchange. I got the baton out. I seemed to be a little ahead. I was able to concentrate, keep focused, run relaxed, run through the tape, and I knew it would take a lot for Tony Dees to overcome me.
Well, we're hearing officially right now that the race is a dead heat, and I have the coach of the Florida Clippers, because I can't get the team members over here fast enough. Wilbur Ross has done a fabulous job with the gentleman down there in both the sprints and the hurdles. Wilbur, there can't ever be a real dead heat, can there?
No, not really. That's the reason why I'm down to review the tapes. Listen, two great teams ran a great race, and the thing about it is that if it's a dead heat, then that's what it is. But I know that somebody is seeing something they're not seeing. We enjoy the fact that we have won a lot of races, but when we run against Santa Monica, you're running against the Cadillac of track and field, and we were happy to just be in there with them. All of these gentlemen here, they ran an outstanding race. Somehow we just didn't get the times we wanted, but it was great. It was great, believe me.
Well, an awful spirited competition between these two particular teams. I'm sure we'll see more in the future. Back up to Bob and Larry.
Thanks, Dwight. I have a feeling we're going to be hearing about the finish for some time to come, and these two teams will meet again. Here's another look as the Santa Monica Track Club with Henry Thomas and the Florida Clippers with Tony Dees run to a dead heat, 39-21. We'll be right back. Back live at Modesto, California for the S&W Modesto Invitational. Bob Varsha and Larry Rawson with you. Dwight Stones down at field level. There has been a lot of talk in the last week and a lot of developments since we last spoke to you from Gainesville, Florida, dealing with drugs in track and field. Here's Larry with an update on the situation.
The headlines have reflected upheaval in track and field for the last couple of weeks. Olympic long jump medalist Larry Myricks suspended for 3 months. Henry Marsh, for failing to show up at an appointed time, suspended for 2 years. The 1983 and 87 hurdles world champion Greg Foster down. Additional suspensions have come out in the prior month. One of the chief architects of the program, Harvey Glantz, has resigned two of his three positions with TAC. I spoke with him last week, and while he reflected frustrations with the program, he said he intended to stay with it. Things have changed in the last 5 days. There are the resignations that have taken place. Edwin Moses, probably the guiding light of the whole spirit. Harvey as well. Dorianne Lambelet, who has worked with Edwin on the legal ramifications, and herself an 800-meter runner. Linda Shesky, a distance runner who has contributed mightily to it. Those are probably the principal people, Bob. And what strikes me about it that we should say that hasn't been dealt with enough is Harvey Glantz told me that since they've instituted random testing, that the amount of cold medicine use that has shown up in drug testing has increased threefold as people using steroids opioids have dropped dramatically. Point being, maybe it's used as a stimulant. Some of the amount of the drugs found in the coal stimulants have been up to 23 times the normal amount that is allowed by TAC law, and we're dealing with veterans here.
And that obviously raises a red flag in the minds of officials. So my question is, when is the burden of proof going to switch to the athletes to prove that they are not dealing in steroids and other performance-enhancing drugs? For more on that, let's go down Dwight Stones and get your comments.
Well, you guys know I've always been the first to defend athletes. However, it seems as though in the last couple of weeks we are getting indications that the athletes are starting to use these cold medications in a much higher dose than just is medicinally allowed. Is it a masking agent? Is it a stimulant? We don't know. Larry Myricks and Greg Foster have been around almost as long as I was around in track and field, and they know better than to take some of these substances. They are on lists that they know that the substances are banned on the doping list. So now I have to change my mindset. I wonder what is going on now. Is there rampant steroid use and they're finding new ways to mask it, and some of these cold medications are the answer to masking. Also, with regards to the people that have resigned, Medwin Moses has devoted a year to a year and a half of his life to this drug program. Not a tremendous amount of cooperation from the office, the TAC office in Indianapolis. A lot of problems there, and as there have always been. I don't think that any of us want to see major athletes suspended for drug use, but if they are using these drugs and they are breaking the rules, then they deserve to be out because they're giving the wrong message to the kids that are coming up through college and the kids that are hopefully watching this program who are in junior high school and high school that aspire to be Olympic champions. I think we need to clean it up, but we have to have cooperation from the TAC office, and if we don't have both of those things, we can't get to where we want to be.
Thank you, Dwight. Certainly we haven't heard the edge of this, the end of this story, I should say, particularly with regard to Edwin Moses. A lot of questions yet to be answered. Behooves the officials to come forward. More in a moment. Welcome back to the S&W Modesto Invitational, coming to you from Modesto, California. We've already seen the power of the Santa Monica Track Club, who ran to a dead heat in the 400 relay. Let's take a closer look at this club with Larry.
1972, the Santa Monica Track Club was formed. The impact to the sport by the 80s was significant. The pinnacle of this impact may have been achieved in Seoul in the Olympic 200-meter dash, when Joe DeLoach and Carl Lewis raced to the Olympic gold and silver medals respectively, both from the Santa Monica Track Club. The man who co-founded the club, coaches some of its athletes to this day, and guides the organization is Joe Douglas.
We formed the club in 1972 with the specific goal to train athletes and prepare them to be successful in international competition. We wanted to provide coaching and a foundation so that they could win gold medals in the Olympics. From 1972 to 80, we won approximately 4 national championships in cross country and other long distance races. In 1980, Carl Lewis joined us, and then the club became a linear improvement and much more accelerated. The club has been successful. We had about 20 athletes qualify for the Olympic trials in 1980. And today we have approximately 27 national class athletes, 15 elite athletes, and many community athletes. In 1988, we won, we being the Santa Monica Track Club. These athletes won 60% of the men's gold medals, and they won 40% of all the men's medals at the Seoul Olympic Games.
Help each other a lot. We push each other. We give each other motivation. When someone doesn't have the ability that someone else has, as soon as they become a part of the team and they start training with us, most likely they'll become a better athlete because there are people there who are pushing. You know, we're saying, run harder, push harder. You know, you can be just as good as we are.
Definitely, Santa Monica Track Club has made me a better athlete and a person, because it means so much to be a part of something, some type of support structure. I know that I have a tremendous family at home that loves me and cares a whole lot about me, but Santa Monica Track Club is my on-the-road family, and we have a great group of athletes and individuals that are so talented and do so much with that talent. And for me to be a part of that, number one, is just great. But to see those other guys at the meet doing well just really, really moves me in a very positive way.
Family counselors often talk about the value that can be derived when one comes from a large support system. Joe Douglas has seen it work.
Strength, our power is in our family atmosphere and with us sticking together to try to move the sport forward to be stronger for ourselves and for track and field.
Family atmosphere, the club system that used to be strong in the United States and has made track an enduring popular sport in Europe. A lot of folks think it should come back. Let's get caught up now with the field events and Dwight Stones.
All right, Bob, we're going to look in on the pole vault. Always a good event here in Modesto because of the same prevailing winds that help in the discus. The men's world record in the pole vault by Sergei Bubka, 19 feet, 10 and a half inches. When will he jump 20 feet? Maybe this year. Joe Dial, the American record holder, 19, 6 and a half. He is in today's field, struggling a little bit both this indoor season and this outdoor season. Here's the field in the competition. You can see people like Doug Fraley has a personal best of 18 feet 11 inches, a veteran Greg Duplantis, a 19-footer, Scott Huffman, an 18-8 competitor. Dean Starkey, who is on the runway currently, also jumped 18-8 for a personal best. Out of Illinois, now competing for the New York Athletic Club, he is really on the fringe of breaking through. He could be one of our next great vaulters. Tremendous amount of talent, very strong upper body, needs to work on his speed on the runway a little bit and his technique. The wind here is outstanding if it blows consistently, and that's the problem. Sometimes the wind gets blowing so fast that the athletes can't handle it. And there is Dean Starkey for his third attempt at 17.6 and a half. I saw some of his warm-up jumps. They were very, very good, but this vacillating wind that's very difficult for the athletes to adjust to sometimes can sometimes spell disaster. Other athletes adapt to it much better. Starkey, again, has to have a little bit more speed on the runway, but it's a little concerned when he has too much wind behind him. When you have too much wind and you have too much speed, maybe the pole that you're bending isn't stiff enough and won't give you the type of catapult that you need. He did not get his height over the bar. He got his height before the bar. Look at his hips on this. Plenty of hip height to make 17.6 and a half, but it's about 6 inches in front of the bar, and he hits it on the way down, and Dean Starkey is out of the pole vault competition today here in Modesto.
Well, that point of view camera gives you a great idea what it's like to be 17 plus feet in the air and about to land on your back. That takes some incredible coordination and, I would say, courage.
It's Eric White measuring distance between where his pole will stop at the box and where he will push off. There is a varying amount of distance there. The standards can be moved forward and back equal to the plane of the back of the pole vault box. Used to be that when you let go of the pole, it wasn't allowed to go under the bar. In fact, John Pinnell may have been the Olympic champion in 1968, except when he made the winning height, his pole passed under the bar, and he was therefore given a miss for that particular attempt. This is Eric White's third and final attempt, again at 17.6 and a half. This is a height that many meets usually start at, or sometimes this is lower than the height that they start at, but because of the strange conditions here, they have decided to start the bar a little bit lower, and a lot of the athletes are struggling. This is Eric White, final attempt, 17.6 and a half, and he didn't have the hip height that Dean Starkey had, and he also had other problems adjusting to where the standard should be, but that was not a jump that would have allowed him to clear 17.6 and a half regardless of where his height had been.
Dwight, what's the story with the wind down there? Is it swirling on them down there?
It's vacillating. It'll blow real hard, maybe 8, 10 miles an hour, and then like right now, right this moment, there's nothing. And it's very difficult. A step can be off by as much as 9 inches to a foot. The pole selection is not as intelligent with a big wind as it would be with a little bit of wind. And you can see here, Eric is just crashing into the bar.
And so Eric White is out of the pole vault competition. We have men's 110-meter high hurdles coming up with a great, great field. We'll tell you more about that when we return to Modesto, California in a moment. Still very warm in Modesto, California, in the S&W Modesto Invitational track and field here on ESPN. The flags are just about rippling now as the wind has picked up remarkably. Ready for the men's 110-meter high hurdles, 12.92. Roger Kingdom, the world and American record set in Zurich last year. The collegiate mark 13 flat, still held by Ronaldo Nehemiah. Here's the way they'll line up. Malcolm Dixon from the South Bay Track Club in lane one. Andrew Parker from Jamaica in lane two. Rod Jett with the AccuSplit Club next to Tony Campbell, a three-time Olympian. Tony Dees from the Florida Clippers, who took that bad fall after the men's 4x100. Robert Redding, former national collegiate champion, will be next to him. Courtney Hawkins from the Santa Monica Track Club. Eugene Swift, the best named athlete in the field. And Pat Duffy from the Body Glove Club. We'll take a look at Tony Dees just on his right shoulder, the left as we look at him. You can see where the skin has been ripped away. We talked with him before the meet about the great season he's had and a little bit about the technique of running the hurdles. And we asked him what were the keys to getting a good race.
Clear each hurdle without hitting any barriers, making it over the first three first. Afterwards, I feel that there's no athlete hurdler that can compete with me.
Gotcha.
After I've cleared the first three hurdles, because the latter part of my race is the fastest and most strongest. And especially at the finish, I'm most dominant.
If Tony Dees was running in the first Olympic Games in this distance, he'd beat everybody else by one-third the length of the football field. Look at his credits in 1990. He is, I think, the man to beat in this race, despite the Olympic bronze medalist Tony Campbell in the race. Several other strong, talented runners as well.
You don't often find a guy who runs the hurdles and the flat sprints as well, but Tony Dees can do that.
But, Bob, there's a lot of logic in there as you look at the back of Tony Campbell as he's getting settled into the blocks. These guys are all sprinters. They have tremendous speed. They can run 4x100-meter relays. You have to be very talented sprinters to be this fast over 10 hurdles, 3.5 feet high.
What I was getting to is the point that these events are often run back-to-back in meets, so guys don't get the chance to ply their trade in both. Tony Dees was the winner of the hurdles competition in the Mobile Grand Prix indoors, second in the hurdles, won the flat sprinting portion, so he really does both well.
Well, remember, it's short distance. These guys can recover quickly. They're in excellent shape. Many can run great 400-meter races.
The field is ready. Dixon, Parker, Jett, Tony Campbell, Tony Dees, Robert Redding, Courtney Hawkins, Eugene Swift, and Pat Duffy. Watch the middle three lanes.
Come on, Malcolm!
It's a good start.
Tony Campbell
and Tony Dees in the middle of the screen. Looks like Dees with a little bit of a lead now. Obviously falling at the finish of the men's 4x1 hasn't hurt him. Dees is just running away from this field. Looks like it'll be Dees, Campbell, and Redding unofficially.
That is a quick time. I have no idea what it is. I'm judging his margin of victory over the rest of the talented field.
Unofficially, 13:08.
I was about to say the best time in the world this year is Colin Jackson winning the British Commonwealth Games Championships in 13.08 one-hundredths of a second. Look, he got a great start. He talked about that in our little preview piece, and he's in charge all the way. Look at him drive off the hurdles. He's actually pulling away on the flats, as should be the case with a man with his speed. Look at him lean at the tape.
Officially, it's a wind-aided time. Let's take a look now, head-on.
3.5 feet high, these hurdles. Look at him just begin to skim them. You athletes out there, stay airborne as little time as you can. Snap down that trailing leg quickly. That'll slow you down. It's a talent these guys work on in practice. Look at the margin he's beating even NCAA champions by. The Olympic bronze medalist takes second.
Well, we'll find out whether that shoulder bothered Tony Dees as he makes his way over to talk with Dwight Stones.
Tony Dees, stand up here. I get a chance to see your race there. I want you to show the people at home what you did to yourself in that 4x1. That's rough. That's a very tough track. You went down with a terrible fall, but you just ran unofficially 13:08. We don't know what kind of wind it is. You have had a great indoor season and have already started with a great outdoor season. Your technique has already improved since when I first saw you in January. Where's it going to stop?
I don't know, right? I'm trying to get a WR, but I'm shooting for the 110 hurdles. Until that's done, I want the best.
Did running the 4x1 not really bother you for the hurdles? I mean, the hurdles is also a strength event as well as speed, isn't it?
Actually, I like to run that race before I run the hurdles because it warms me up. Really, normally, my third race is my best race.
I mean, you were doing it all indoor season. You were running the flat 55 or the hurdles first, then the flat second. You almost pulled off an unprecedented double indoors. You won the hurdles, came back 10 minutes later, and just missed winning the 55-meter straight dash. I mean, you proved it indoors. You are somebody to be dealt with in both the sprints and the hurdles. What happened in 6 months from the end of last season to this season that has made you such a threat?
Complete dedication, Dwight, to the sport more or less. I mean, I said either I do it this year or I quit the sport, and I want it real bad. I want the world record is what I'm shooting for, and that's what I want.
Okay, well, that's a very formidable obstacle in your way. Roger Kingdon, the world record holder, but you got your sights set on him. Tony Dees will be following you all during the outdoor season.
So Tony Dees is our winner, a personal favorite of George Steinbrenner, who runs the Florida Clippers Club. Steinbrenner himself, a former hurdler and sprinter.
The wind just slightly over the allowable limit of 4.5 miles per hour. It was up at about 5.5, a terrific effort, 13.09.
Tony Dees, after coming to a dead heat in the men's 4x100 relay, now comes through to win the men's hurdles. More in a moment.
That's right, track one.
Official results in the men's 110-meter hurdles. Tony Dees, 13.09 seconds, but it was wind-aided, as Larry mentioned. Tony Campbell and Robert Redding coming home second and third. We're ready now for the men's flat 100 meters. The world and American record, 9.92, held by Carl Lewis, set in Seoul, South Korea in September of 1988 at the Olympic Games, at which Ben Johnson achieved such notoriety. Collegiate record, 9.93 at altitude. The low altitude mark, 9.94 by Leroy Burrell. Here is your field. It will be Henry Thomas in lane one, next to Patrick Williams, Mark Witherspoon coming back from the relay. Atlee Mahorn also ran in that race, as did Joe Deloach, Augustine Alabia, Jeff Williams, and Luis Pancho Morales.
100 meters is 109 yards, 1 foot, 1 inch, and there's a very fast man.
Joe Deloach, 22 years of age. He's one of the athletes we spoke to before the meet. We asked him about his concentration in the 100 meters this season.
I understand the 200. I feel natural. I feel like I'm just a natural 200-meter runner. I go out there and don't have to really think about the race and just run it. Naturally, I know when to accelerate and when to maintain. Well, in the 100, it's a whole different thing. Yes, I do feel like I'm capable of running really, really fast in the 100, and that's one of my objectives for this season and between now and the Olympic Games, is to break that 200-meter mold that everybody's put Joe Deloach in since I won the gold medal in the 200 meters.
There's Jumpin' Joe's a talent. We called him Joltin' Joe. He was eighth ranked in the world in 1988. There's nothing the matter with his sprinting, but a fast 100 meters helps your 200-meter time. The time you see at 200 meters is the fastest ever run at sea level. There is Deloach, young man from Texas that was recruited by Carl Lewis, trains with him a lot. He said Carl has been a tremendous inspiration in his life as a friend and as a training partner. There's a man who might even be in better shape than Joe Deloach, Mark Witherspoon. And he beat Carl and said it really helped him psychologically continue on running in 1987 at the National Championships. He's in tremendous physical shape. We'll see how mentally strong he is against Deloach. Henry Thomas, another member of the Santa Monica Track Club, ranked number eighth in the world in the past, and he was the anchor man that you saw earlier today race Tony Dees to the virtual dead heat.
Perhaps the best all-around sprinter in the world, Henry Thomas. 10:15 is his personal best for 100 meters, 20.18 at 200 meters, 45.05 at 400 meters. There's a good look at Atlee Mahorn from Canada.
He's been world-ranked among the top 10 at 200 meters in the past. In the race, now a senior at Cal Berkeley, is Atlee Mahorn.
He is also the Canadian national record holder at 20.20. Born in Jamaica, as was Ben Johnson, ironically enough. He was also the Commonwealth champion at 200 meters back in 1986.
Watch Deloach in lane six. We've got a little time here. The key lanes to watch, I think, are lane two with Henry Thomas, lane four with Mark Witherspoon, Joe Deloach in six. There is Atlee Mahorn. Fastest times ever run. The A stands for altitude. Calvin Smith did it at our U.S. Olympic Festival in 1983. Jimmy Hines at Mexico City. The other times were run at sea level. Burrell at our TAC National Championships on his home track in Houston last year. Carl Lewis did it at the Olympics. Almost missed the fastest time ever run. When he leaned up at the tape just a little bit, when he realized he wasn't going to catch Ben, but it didn't make quite the difference, and he's the world record holder now.
I wonder what it's going to mean for Joe Deloach. He has beaten his idol, Carl Lewis, at the 200. Perhaps Joe considers that his better event. I wonder what you have to do psychologically to beat a guy that you look up to for so long at his best event. I wonder if that poses some kind of a psychological hurdle for
him. I really, knowing Joe Deloach, don't think it does. Let's watch, see who gets out of the blocks well. Watch lane six.
Good start. Witherspoon appearing to pull away. Witherspoon with Williams on his left. Witherspoon, I think.
Pat Williams, can you believe that? From the University of Idaho. That is the upset, certainly, of 1990 in sprinting throughout the world.
Forgive our stunned silence during the race. The crowd couldn't believe it either. There's about 6,000 people in the stands here. And for a guy from the University of Idaho, Pat Williams, whose PR coming in was 10:25, has just stolen a race from some of the best flat sprinters in the world. Let's take another look.
Absolutely unbelievable. He got away evenly. He was out with Witherspoon and also Deloach. I am sure everybody in the stands saying, can I see a replay? What is it? You at home can see it. He had control of the race all the way. Look at this. Even a man faster than he is with longer legs on the closing last few yards, Witherspoon, could not catch him.
He'll be at the far right of your screen as our camera concentrates on the Witherspoon Mahorn Deloach setup in the middle of the track. But watch the man in dark shorts and white shirt to the right of your screen, powering down the strip, holding Witherspoon at bay. Good charge by Witherspoon, good lean at the tape.
Unbelievable. Absolutely unbelievable. Ladies and gentlemen, that was not a windy race. It's legal. We have 10.05 seconds, fastest by an American and almost the fastest in the world this year.
Well, let's hear how the winner likes his new personal best. Here's Dwight.
Take a look at this face. This is the face that just upset an outstanding 100-meter field. We are getting an unofficial time of 10:05 legal. Pat Williams from the University of Idaho, did you ever believe in your wildest dreams that you would overhaul a field that consisted of Mark Witherspoon and Henry Thomas?
I knew it was possible if I was able to carry out Mary's plan, and I was able to do that, so.
You feel you had nothing to lose in this race, that if you ran fourth and ran well, it didn't matter?
It didn't matter, since as they were accomplished runners, and I was just an unknown trying to prove something.
Well, after today, I don't think that you're going to be unknown. Pat Williams, the winner of the men's 100 meters. Fellas?
And the entire track world is going to be familiar with Pat Williams very soon. Officially, 10:06 his time. Still counts as a big personal best. Mark Witherspoon second at 10:08. In third, Jeff Williams, 10:23. Let's go down to the pole vault runway now and get caught up with that. 18 feet is the height.
On the runway for his second attempt at 18 feet a half inch is American record holder Joe Dial. He holds that American record at 19 feet, 6.5 inches, was once a world indoor record holder back a few years ago when that record was being traded back and forth between Billy Olson and Sergei Bubka. Joe Dial got a shot and had a world record there for about a week, I think is what it was, as that record changed hands about 7 times during that particular indoor season. He's been struggling indoors. He struggles a little bit outdoors. He really thrives on windy conditions, but his speed is nothing like what I'm used to seeing for Joe Dial, and that is the reason why he didn't quite make it into the pit. He had the hip height in front of the bar, but he just didn't have the speed, the patented Joe Dial speed on the runway. When you're 5 feet 7 inches tall, you have to perform every part of this technique with absolute precision. You can see there his hips are high enough, but his legs drop on the bar on the way down. Joe Dial, very, very strong athlete, but has to have that superior speed on the runway in order to hold high enough on the pole to execute heights in excess of 18 feet a half inches. We look at the official results or unofficial results at 10:05 for Patrick Williams beating Mark Witherspoon and Henry Thomas. We'll be back with more S&W Modesto Invitational after this.
Welcome back to Modesto, California, where we're ready for the women's 100 meters in the S&W Modesto Invitational, the world and American records, 10:49 in the era of FloJo, Florence Griffith Joyner. I'm gonna get my tongue loosened up today. We have a good field. One lane two will be open, as is lane one. Mona Simmons will be running in lane three out of Cal Berkeley. Tina Davis in lane four. Christy Gaines in lane five. Juliet Cuthbert will be in lane six, a Jamaican athlete. Cindy Hill in lane seven. Angela Burnham next to her. And Mina Hutchins from Cal Berkeley in lane nine.
Well, there you see Stanford's Christy Gaines, a terrific young talent. Gaines, there you see her personal best, 11:31. Very fine running, and she is now the Stanford record holder.
The 1989 National Junior Champion at 100 meters.
26-year-old Julie Cuthbert from Jamaica. And they have produced great male and female sprinters over the years. As a matter of fact, the person who just won the last race from the University of Idaho, he is a Jamaican.
The 86 NCAA 100 and 200 meter champion.
There you see Angela Burnham in the blocks.
Come on, Cindy!
Watch lanes 5, 6, and 8.
False start.
All right, Burnham to set the field again. There's Christy Gaines, and she is right now out in lane 5. Here you see see the five fastest times ever run. Flojo way out by 2 yards. Can you believe that? Evelyn Ashford running the equivalent of a 9.6 100-yard dash with her 100-meter time. Don Sowell running extremely well. Did that at altitude at Brigham Young University last year. Marlies Gurr, Marita Koch, East Germans. Sheila Eccles rounding out the fifth place time.
There's a look at Angela Burnham out of UCLA. Female High School Athlete of the Year could be the next great find in American female sprinters. We mentioned Dawn Sowell. We'll probably be seeing her in a couple of weeks at the Jack in the Box meet in Los Angeles. Sowell, I understand, has now entered that meet. It was in all the papers here in the San Joaquin Valley area this weekend. Juliet Cuthbert, 26 years of age. Oldest runner in the field, the youngest, Christy Gaines, is just 19.
Cuthbert, a superb starter. Watch her in lane six, see if she gets out first in the middle of the track.
Good start. Actually, I think Cuthbert got beat on that start, Larry. Julie Cuthbert going with Christy Gaines. Gaines and Cuthbert. Gaines now in red, pulling away, powering to the finish. Gaines, Cuthbert, and Angela Burnham, I make it unofficially.
You are correct. That's the way I saw it, too. Christy Gaines running very well. You see the tall, powerful stride. She reminds me a little bit of Flojo. Unofficially, we have 11 and 36 one-hundredths of a second. We don't know about the win. Watch them get out well. The three in the middle of the track did, but then it turned into a race between Gaines, who is in red, and Cuthbert running with the arms powering her upright in black. And it was Gaines pulling away. The tall, lean young lady, the Stanford record holder, wins by about 2 meters, 6 feet.
11:36, unofficially. Great finish there for Christy Gaines over Juliet Cuthbert and Angela Burnham. We'll be back with more from Modesto. We're back at Modesto, California, where the temperatures have cooled off a little bit, but the wind continues to blow, causing problems for the pole vaulters and for the other field events going on. We'll get through that in a moment. Let's take a look now at the history of this great meet.
The written word in all of the books of life should be as rich as the history of the S&W Modesto Invitational. 30 world records have been set here, including four separate occasions in the 100-yard dash or the 100 meters, where the title of world's fastest human was bestowed on someone new. In 1942, the pole vault was the first event to have a world record set here at Modesto. The hurdles races have produced over the years some of the fiercest competition at Modesto. While relays have produced 15 world records, individual stars have abounded here as well. Canada's Harry Jerome tied the hand-timed 100-yard dash and 100-meter records with times of 9.2 and 10 flat. Rafer Johnson competed in 11 decathlons in his career, including the 1956 Olympic silver medal and the 1960 gold. For over 15 years, Debbie Brill of Canada was a world-class performer, competing at Modesto often. The 1972 Modesto meet saw the 68 Olympic champion Willie Davenport edge out future Olympic champ Rod Milburn. Jim Ryan nipped John Garrison at the finish line in 1965. Less than 1 month later, he would beat Olympic champion Peter Snell while still a high school senior. Only three high schoolers have ever broken 4 minutes for the mile. Jim Ryan, Tim Danielson, and the last to achieve it, Marty LaQuarrie, over 20 years ago. The respected meet director for the last 46 years is former world record holder in the high hurdles, Tom Moore.
Well, I was really interested in track. After I got to get out of the University of California, I ran for the Olympic Club for about 12 years. I was known as the old man of the hurdles. But I was so interested in track, I just naturally evolved into being meet director.
Segrin thrilled the crowd for years here in the 70s. He was the 1968 Olympic champion in the pole vault that took silver in 1972. All right, whatever, throw it in.
Welcome back to Modesto, where there is such a great, great history. Next year celebrating its 50th anniversary. Let's take a look at the results as we have had them thus far in the events now complete here in Modesto. In the women's 800 meters, it was Michelle Taylor powering away from the field to win by nearly 2 full seconds over Leslie Knoll and Marcia Tate. men's 4x100. They're calling it a dead heat. The Florida Clippers and the Santa Monica Track Club. Lynn Junior College coming home third. Men's 110 hurdles, Tony Dees, despite falling at the end of the 4x100, got up and blew away Tony Campbell and Robert Redding. But in the men's 100, Jamaican Patrick Williams from the University of Idaho with a big personal improvement, knocking off Mark Witherspoon and Atlee Mahorn. In the women's 100, Christy Gaines, just 19 years young, at 11:39, a legal time over Juliet Cuthbert and Angela Burnham. Now let's go down to Dwight Stones and learn what we can about field events that are finished. I think we're going to hear about the discus and the hammer throw. Take it away, Dwight.
Now it's time to look at some of the hammer and discus throwing that we talked about earlier. Let's hammer here. Ken Flax from the United States, one of the most consistent throwers in recent memory. An outstanding performance here at the Modesto Invitational. Flax has consistently gained each year and become one of the U.S. leading throwers. Happy with that throw here. This event takes place earlier in the afternoon so that everyone can watch the competition. It's a very strong athlete, spins very strong through the center, getting some good extension with his arms. And gets to the front of the circle and puts everything he has. All the momentum of his body is transferred in through that chain into that 16-pound ball at the end. And Ken Flax gets out to 253 feet, 1 inch. An outstanding early season throw for Flax. Now, we had a guest competitor from the Soviet Union. In fact, what he prefers to be referred to as from Estonia, Yuri Tam, one of the great trio of Soviet hammer throwers over the last few years. Tam over here visiting, training a little bit, enjoying the freedom that is coming along with the Eastern Bloc opening up. Bronze medalist in the 1980 and 88 Olympic Games. He has been around a long time. Medals in World Cup, European Cup, ranked in the world the last 10 years. Also a very strong athlete through the middle of the phases. The hammer throwers from the Soviet Union are so technically efficient. We have hundreds of football players that if we were to put them in the hammer throw and teach them the technique, the Americans would dominate this particular event. But unfortunately, there's more money in football than there is in hammer throwing. Yuri Tam from the Soviet Union, the winner of the hammer throw. Now here we are with Wolfgang Schmidt, a great veteran for years in the discus, 36 years young, now competing for West Germany. He becomes eligible this year to compete for West Germany internationally. He will represent them at the European Championships in August in Yugoslavia and will represent them in the World Championships in Tokyo next year, as well as the Olympic Games in Barcelona, and he is thrilled. What a specimen, 6 feet 6 inches, 265 pounds, an outstanding technician, former world record holder, Olympic medalist in 1976 behind Mack Wilkins. And he always explodes well early season. And he gets out to a throw that leads the world in 1990, 224 feet, 1 inch on his sixth and final throw. Wolfie's one of those athletes who gets stronger as the competition goes on. The other throwers always worry about him when it comes to the final rounds. Now, Mike Buncich, who made our Olympic team in 1988 in Seoul. He's here also from the San Jose area. So many great throwers living and training there for a lot of different years. Buncich has the best throw in America this year, or by an American in the world this year, 214 feet 7. Here's the hammer throw. Yuri Tam wins with 255 feet 5 inches. Ken Flax in second, and Judd Logan, our American record holder, struggling a little bit in third place, 235 feet 2 inches. And in the men's discus, Wolfgang Schmidt from West Germany, 224-1, the best throw in the world this year. Mike Buncich, the best American throw in the world this year, and in third place, Cami Kashmiri, our national outdoor champion in 1989, comes in for 30s back to Reno and has had a few injuries this year. And we'll be back with more exciting action from the S&W Modesto Invitational, the men's 400, after this.
Back at the S&W Modesto Invitational, where we're ready for the men's 400 meters, 43.29, the world and American record held by Butch Reynolds. Here's the way they'll line up. Terrence Riley in lane one, next to Gary Duncan. Bert Cameron, the Jamaican Olympic star, in lane three, next to Oliver Bridget. Marlon Cannon, Clarence Daniel, Devin Morris, Mike Stevenson, and Samuel Matete, a Zambian athlete running for Blinn Junior College.
Solid field. We've had better, I guess, at different times over the years, but this is a very good field. Bert Cameron, formerly ranked number one in the world. This guy's a real talent. and despite being 30 years of age, has an excellent chance to win this. It's hard to be the best in the world when you're 30 at the 400 meters. That's the old, and this right here in front of you is the new in the field. This man is 19 years of age, and he was the big high school star, did not qualify for school. This is Marlon Cannon. Excuse me, that who you saw, there's Clarence Daniel. That was Marlon Cannon's back. Daniel is ranked number 9 in the world in the United States last year.
Their way, Riley, Duncan, Cameron, Bridges, Cannon, Daniel, Morris, Stevenson, and Matete. We're looking at the middle of the track, as usual, for Cameron, Bridges, Cannon, and Daniel.
Moving up in the middle of the track, the white and red top.
Cameron running strongly, 30 years of age, phenomenal for a sprinter. Marlon Cannon, the 19-year-old next to him, is done away with. Matete very strong, but he is way out in lane 9.
That is Clarence Daniel powering down the home stretch with about a 4-yard lead on his inside. Is Brett Cameron moving up into second place.
In third place, Oliver Bridges, but right now the race belongs to Clarence Daniel. It is Daniel, Cameron, and Bridges, by my unofficial judgment.
All that support that George Steinbrenner deserves a tip of the hat is providing down in Tampa to these athletes is showing up. D's good, consistent running has performed brilliantly here. 44.94, that's the fastest American in the world if it holds up. Second place looks like it might have gone to Cameron, and third, as you said, Oliver Bridges. Unofficially, amazing performance here with a wind on the backstretch that's been a problem. There you see Cameron in yellow, and he is out there occupying lane 3, and he powers along, but moving up well, and a man he's actually chasing is Clarence Daniel. Watch as they come off the turn. They'll have about 115, 120 meters to go. As you now see the widescreen picture, Daniel is on his outside. He can see him, but he simply can't catch him. He ran a very strong first 200 meters, Clarence did. Improving on his performance last year, he ran 45.09, and he's much better already this year.
Youth not being served in this race. First, second, and third. Daniel, 28 years of age. Bridges, 28 years of age. Cameron, 30 years of age.
Good point, Bob.
There are your results unofficially. 44.94 for Clarence Daniel, Burt Cameron, Oliver Bridges comes third. World leader at this point, perhaps. We'll learn more later. We're going to take a quick timeout, and when we come back, the men's 1,500-meter matchup we talked about earlier, the contrasting styles of Padilla and Gray.
Welcome back to the S&W Modesto Invitational. We're going to look at some long jump right now, and on your screen is Andre Esser, who has been on the brink of greatness in the long jump. Of course, the United States, a dominant power in that particular event, sweeping the medals in Seoul with Carl Lewis winning, Mike Powell second, who is in this field, and Larry Myricks, the bronze medalist. But Andre Esser starting to make his presence known, jumping very well this year, is in second place currently behind Mike Powell with 27 feet, 3/4 of an inch, wind aided. That would have been beyond his personal best if it had been a legal jump, but we have gusting winds here, and all the runways are in the direction to take advantage of that wind. Esser, one of those athletes with very good speed, still needs to work some on his technique. Arms aren't quite as efficient as we are used to seeing Carl Lewis, Larry Myricks, and Esser just puts his foot down and runs through. Let's go back up to Bob and Larry, getting ready for the men's 1,500 meters.
As you look at Esser on the screen there, he's thinking of moving from Shreveport to Gainesville to get some good training.
Here are the records for the 1,500. 3:29.46, Saeed Owida in 1985. That same year, nationalized American Sidney Marie set the American record of 3:29.77. A big field, just as we had on the women's 800. Big 1,500-meter field. Dave Strang from Stanford University. Doug Padilla, who will be the American 5,000-meter national champion. Bill Crowley from Stanford. Johnny Gray from the Santa Monica Track Club. The speedster we talked about. Wes Ashford from BYU, who runs often with Doug Padilla. Chris Cushing Murray, Eric Mastalier, Paul Greer, Eric's twin brother, Mark Mastalier, will also be in the field. Roni Mayos from Israel, Dave Ottaway from England, Mark Olden, Mark Goulet, Brian Presson, Jason Lanau, Rod Heskett, and Ernie Freer.
This reminds me of a European track meet where they stack everybody up in the corner, wedge them together, and fire the gun. It looks like a cross-country meet on the track.
What you wind up with is a lot of flying elbows. What a chorus line across that start.
There you see Doug Padilla wearing the number 2 on his left hip. Let's see if he tucks behind everybody and stays out of the traffic. No, he's trying to sneak by on the inside. Watch Padilla, he's third right now. This is the largest field I think I can remember seeing in a mile. Dave Strang begins to pull away on the pole.
Strang will be setting the early pace. Now remember, they're just about to make this gentle turn three into a wind that at this point is still rippling the flags here in Modesto. You can see the California flag there on the pole. It is a strong, strong breeze. That's going to take something out of the runners, and it may change the tactics of the race, Larry.
Well, you want to stay behind Indian File here. It won't hurt you too much as you look at Doug Padilla right now, who is running in fourth place, but it won't hurt too much in an Indian File race to blow into the wind like these guys are doing, because somebody in front of you just pushes the air aside.
Dave Strang is a junior from South Africa originally, 21 years of age, with a best of 3:47.69 for the distance, and he is quickly moving away.
There you see in second place is Bill Crowley from Massachusetts. He was a top two-miler and has run 3:41, which is the equivalent of a 3:58 mile, and he's got a gulf there. He's in no man's land. 57.4 for the first 400 meters of this 1,500-meter race. Johnny Gray, an interesting story, running right now in third place. He is a terrific talent, world-ranked, world championship finalist, Olympic Games finalist, American record holder at 800 meters, now in third place. This is his first serious attempt at a 1,500 meters or a mile. He's in third, a little bear watching. There you see him, number 466. He and Padilla. Padilla's been sick for the last couple of weeks, has been getting better the last couple of days. He's now, right now, in sixth place.
It is Dave Strang from Stanford with about a 25-yard lead over Bill Crowley from Stanford. In third place is Johnny Gray.
Cushing Murray from Santa Monica Track Club is in fourth. Doug Padilla resting right now in sixth. The Masteliers are running back in ninth and tenth. They were 408 high school milers in Jesuit High School in Northern California.
158.7 at 800 meters. And now they're beginning to reel in as your base strength has pulled off. Now taking over the pacing job is Bill Crowley.
Johnny Gray, this should seem very comfortable for him. After he passes, I'd say right about this point in the race, he's in a bit of foreign territory. He's run 1,000-meter races, which he's passed. He's not experienced, although he trains hard at interval work, at running the full mile distance.
The pack beginning to close up on Bill Crowley, who is handling this third lap. There is Johnny Gray. Right next to him, Chris Cushing Murray.
Still Crowley and Gray.
Now moving up quickly.
That is Wes Ashford, who runs from Utah, a friend of Padilla's, and that was a three-quarter rabbit leg run by Crowley. It is Johnny Gray right now in the lead, less than a lap to go. Ashford in second, Murray in third, Padilla in fourth. The question is, will Padilla have his speed coming off sickness?
The pace has not been fast, so you've got to believe that Doug Padilla, despite some of the recent illness that Larry talked about, 3 minutes for the third lap. Now Doug Padilla moving up on the outside very quickly from fourth to third. Now he is second. He'll challenge Johnny Gray before they hit into the corner. Will Gray hold him off? Yes. Cushing Murray moving up. Wes Ashford is still in it. Crowley is still in it in fifth place. It is a five-man race now, but all eyes are on the man up front, Johnny Gray. Quick look over his shoulder. Looking for Doug Padilla. Down the straight they come. He drifts out, but Padilla, with a great burst of speed, comes charging through. Johnny Gray, perhaps with a little too much distance. It is Padilla, Johnny Gray, and Christian Cushing Murray. Fourth is Wes Ashford. And then a tremendous battle for fifth position.
3:41.96 unofficially. That's the equivalent of about a 3:59 mile. Not bad for Padilla coming back from sickness, and a good debut by Johnny Gray.
And here is the stretch run once again. Watch Johnny Gray, who looks quickly to his right. Here comes Doug Padilla.
Bob, I don't think he had his usual zip here. Padilla would not have pulled up on his shoulder and run that way around the turn. Normally, Doug would have blown by the leader and run hard the whole last 200 meters. I think he's grateful to feel better the last 3 or 4 days and win the race. Nice victory lap. Johnny Gray deserves it. A lot of half-milers, 400-meter runners hate to step up to a longer race. And he certainly had a very fine debut, running the equivalent of a four-minute mile.
And give credit, too, to Christian Cushing Murray, who ran a very savvy race for his best performance in a world-class meet like this. 3:41.96. Unofficially, Doug Padilla wins the battle between the distance runner and the sprinter. It is Padilla, Gray, and Cushing Murray. More from Modesto in a moment.
Welcome back to the S&W Modesto Invitational as we take another look at the men's long jump, which is being contested throughout the afternoon. Bill Ayers on the runway. Another one of those sprinter, long jumpers who, were they to learn the technique to the extent that Larry Myricks and Carl Lewis have, it's hard to say what will happen. Everybody's still in pursuit of that 21-year-old world record by Bob Beamon, 29 feet, 2.5 inches set at altitude in Mexico City and winning the gold medal all those many years ago.
Dwight, they've done some studies on this to show that his high altitude jump at sea level would have been around 28.8, which puts him right in Larry Myricks and Carl Lewis territory. I'm referring to Beamon, of course.
And of course, we've both seen Carl Lewis have half inch to one inch scratches.
Right.
Some people say in excess of 30 feet, but that was back 7 or 8 years ago in his career. Some say they don't think that he has it anymore to jump in that area. Ayers, also, same as Esther, misjudging the board because of the gusting winds here at Modesto and unable to have a fair jump, putting his foot down in the middle of an aborted attempt. And now it's time to join our friend Doug Padilla, who has stepped down in distance after Johnny Gray stepped up in distance. And you were content to let everybody sort of break the wind for you there, so to speak, and just hang on Johnny Gray. I thought you might go a little bit earlier than that, that you might respect Johnny's speed the last 100 meters a little more.
Yeah, I was a little worried. We got to 200, and Johnny's not a guy you really want to be next to on the home stretch. But it's early in the season. I've been a little questionable, and so it's a lot better to be a little conservative and have a good kick than to go too hard and walk the last home stretch. So I felt like that was my best chance.
One of the reasons your 1990 indoor season was so outstanding was that for the first time in many years, you were healthy. Now it seems as though you've had some flare-ups of some other illnesses that you've had to deal with all these many years. At 33 years old, how much more time can you afford off having to deal with illnesses and little nagging injuries?
Well, one thing is I don't have any choice. You know, you do the best you can with what's given you. I think it's kind of avoidable to a degree.
I'll be back. I'm happy I finished today. It's a great runner here.
Hey, good
watch
speed.
Out for Jay Graham. I'm coming up. Coming to get you.
Good speed down the home stretch against a good half miler.
Very good. Very good. A guy stepping down from the 5,000, a guy stepping up from the 800. Doug Padilla, our winner in the 1,500. Johnny Gray, very happy just to have finished the race. Let's go back upstairs for the 200 meters.
All right, thanks very much. $15,000 won by that man, Doug Padilla, last year in the Mobile Grand Prix competition. Men's 200 meters, the world record 1972 at altitude set by Pietro Mannea of Italy back in 1979. The American mark 1975 set by Carl Lewis and matched by Joe DeLoach. Here's the way they'll line up from Jamaica. Mark Sr. will be in lane one. In lane two, African Gabriel Tiako. Stanley Kerr will be in lane three. Lane four will be Danny Everett, who's seen duty in the 4x100 for the Santa Monica Track Club today. Next to him will be Atlee Mahorn from Cal Berkeley. Pat Williams, the surprise winner from Jamaica and the University of Idaho. Surprise winner of that 100 meters. Jeff Williams also in there for the Stars and Stripes Track Club. Lucius Miller from Stars and Stripes from Arizona in 1986. And Lorenzo Daniel with the Florida Clippers.
I wonder if that man on your screen has had a little bit of an anxiety attack, wondering about Pat Williams from the University of Idaho.
Talk about a guy who works hard. We asked Mark Everett about running both the 200 and the 400 this year.
The reason I'm running the 200 meters here at Modesto is because I'm trying to establish myself as both a 400 meter runner and a 200 meter runner. And my earlier races are going to be in the 200 meters, so this year I'll be running a pulse of 402.
There is the young man from Southern California. Check some of the titles, including the bronze medal out of UCLA. He's run 2017. He's in shape to maybe go that fast, although let me add, the first 70 meters here will be into the wind.
I said Mark Everett. Of course, that is Danny Everett. There is the man.
They're both the best in the world in their events right now. Danny Everett, I think, is going to have his hands full here. Let's see. A good 100-meter runner usually runs well at 200 meters. I'm referring to what Pat Williams from Idaho just did in the 100.
Lineup: Senior, Tiako, Kerr, Everett, Mahorn, Williams, Jeff Williams next to Pat Williams, Miller, and Daniel.
Very fine field here for this 200 meters. Again, we're slightly early in the season. As you look at Lorenzo Daniel from the Florida Clippers, still holds the world junior record. What a tremendous time for somebody who's a teenager, almost breaking 20 seconds. Unbelievable. America very strong in this event. You look at Atlee Mahorn doubling back off the 100 meters. Four of the top 10 in the world last year were Americans. We've had up to six.
Now we've had a scratch. Jeff Williams will not be in lane seven, so scratch Williams from seven.
Watch Pat Williams in lane six.
From the inside, senior Chaco.
Danny Everett's in lane four in blue.
Miller and Daniel.
And coming on strong, but next in Stanley Kerr, real strong curve. Onto the straightaway they come, but Williams, who won the 100, comes off the turn first. Can he be run down by Danny Everett? No, on the outside. Danny Everett with an incredible finish, running down Pat Williams. I thought Everett was done with 50 meters to go, but he really found a high gear. I was looking along the outside at Lorenzo Daniel with the Florida Clippers, 20.33 unofficially.
We had him on another watch over here, even slightly faster. We'll see what they come up with. But there you see the start. And it was a very good one on the inside for and running in lane one, Mark Sr. But he got blown away as the race began to unfold. And it was running well on the outside. Lorenzo Daniel out in the far lane, closest to the spectators that you see. Danny Everett was actually third here with 50 to go. You can see him peek out of his eye as I stared at him at the track. And he began to pull away from both Williams and finishing second, Lorenzo Daniel. Daniel, very fine, even race for Danny Everett.
Let's hear about him now with Dwight.
As we've always said, Danny Everett's the kind of guy that you could have a microphone in his face after the finish line of a 400. 200 must be twice as easy. Were you concerned with Pat Williams out there? I mean, he'd won the 100. He obviously thinks he's invincible at this point in time. Were you able to control your race coming off the turn after running into the wind for the first 70 meters?
Yeah, I was really trying to concentrate on running a fine curve, and I did okay. And coming off the curve, I felt I was in decent enough position to move on the back stretch.
Is your philosophy going to be to run some more 200 meters so that you have a better finish in the 400? Because you're going to lose some of your strength training if you run a lot of 200s.
Yeah, I want to work on my speed, and also I want to develop my 200. And so I'm going for getting ranked in the 4 and the 2 this year.
It'll be interesting to see how your progress goes on those particular races. Danny Everett, one of the finest 400 meter runners in the country, now doing a good job at 200 meters.
Boy, it's hard to believe that much strategy actually goes on in a 200-meter sprint. Your winner, Danny Everett, over Lorenzo Daniel and Stanley Kerr. 20:33, 20:35, and 20:50 your time. We'll be back.
Welcome back as we wrap up the 49th annual S&W Modesto Invitational with a last look at some field events. By the way, talking about field events, the high jump is still going on, the men's high jump, and we were unable to get to the women's triple jump. It is going to be contested after the men's long jump. This is Scott Huffman on tape. First attempt at 18.6.5. Now watch his technique over the bar. Very strong, very resilient athlete. Watch that. Looks like he's high jumping over the bar. I've seen him make a number of flips on the way down. Very impressive clearance at 18.6.5. He is in the lead. Mike Powell, the silver medalist from Seoul in the long jump and also the 1990 Slam Fest champion here in the fourth round. Superior speed. Powell is a 200-meter specialist at UC Irvine way back in the early 80s. Fourth attempt, 27 feet, 5 1/4. If he ever learns how to execute the technique properly, he could challenge Bob Beamon's world record. Back up to the booth.
All right, the Slam Fest, a bunch of athletes gathering for slam dunk competition, and he won it. Men's 400 meters, Clarence Daniel, your winner officially, 44.94 over Burt Cameron and Oliver Bridges. The old guys got it done. In the men's 1500 meter, great stretch battle between Doug Padilla, who beat Johnny Gray, 342.01 to 342.43. In the men's 200, Danny Everett, 20.35 over Lorenzo Daniel and Patrick Williams, correcting before I said Stanley Kerr. Larry, a quick comment on what we've watched this afternoon.
I thought Pat Williams was the star, the big surprise, and he did it world-class fashion.
Yeah, we hope you've enjoyed our live coverage of the S&W Modesto Invitational and that you'll join us as track and